Right now on KCCI 8 News Close-Up, State Senator Rob Hogue.
He's hoping to take on Senator Chuck Grassley in the fall. This morning, Senator Hogue joins us to talk about his background, his record at the State House, and what he wants to do in Washington. KCCI 8 News Close-Up starts right now.
This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close-Up.
Good Sunday morning, and thank you very much for joining us here on KCCI 8 News Close-Up. I'm Steve Carlin.
And I'm Stacey Horst. Our guest this morning is Iowa State Senator and U.S. Senate candidate Rob Hogue. He's also a fourth-generation Iowan.
Rob Hogue and his family have strong Iowa roots. His father, Bob, was a math professor at the University of Iowa for 51 years. His mother, Carolyn, a lifelong Iowan, taught math and English in Eastern Iowa public schools. Hogue is serving his third term as a state senator from Cedar Rapids. At the State House, Hogue has served on a number of committees, including education, judiciary, appropriations, and ways and means.
I am a candidate to be Iowa's next United States senator.
Last year, he became chair of the Government Oversight Committee. Hogue is also a published author. In 2013, he released the book, America's Climate Century, What Climate Change Means for America in the 21st Century and What Americans Can Do About It. Hogue and his wife, Kate, have three children and live in Cedar Rapids.
And Senator Hogue, thanks for joining us this morning.
Delighted to be here.
And Senator Hogue, there are three other Democrats in the race for Senate, and they are former lawmakers Tom Feagin, Bob Krause, and former Lieutenant Governor Patty Judge. How do you plan to set yourself apart from the other three, and why would you be the best choice?
Well, Steve, first of all, voters deserve a choice, so I'm excited that we have a contested primary. This is our first contested primary in Iowa in a Democratic U.S. Senate race in a presidential election year in my lifetime and only the second one we've had. So it's good that voters have a choice. I think I'm the best candidate. I have won five elections in a row. I've replaced Republicans twice in state legislative races in 2002 and 2006. I'm the only current office holder. I think voters at home appreciate the work I've done in the Iowa legislature. Every year I've had a bigger margin than I've had before. So part of my argument to Democratic primary voters is I've won races, and I think I can win again this year. I've also been a real champion, as the introduction referenced, for the environment. Climate action, clean energy, clean water. I think that's an issue that's growing importance for a lot of Iowans, and I've been a leader there. I believe in a vibrant, full employment economy that works for all Americans, and I think that's something that sets me apart. And finally, I really believe in a new kind of politics. I think one of the things that really motivates me to run, and I think is really turning Americans off, is how negative all our campaigns have gotten. I've won those five elections in a row. I have never run a 30-second negative attack ad in my career. Obviously, it's fair to point out, hey, there are some policy differences, but I think people want a new kind of politics. So I'm really focused on Iowans in this race. I've gotten to 82 counties. I'm hoping to get to more really soon, and meeting with Iowans across the state to try to uplift our democracy.
Well, Lieutenant Governor Patty Judge has statewide name recognition, yes, which is very important in an election. How do you plan to overcome that?
Yes. Well, I have a lot of respect for Lieutenant Governor Judge, especially because of her work in flood recovery after the floods of 2008. She led that effort for the Culver administration, and we worked very closely together. And it wasn't ever big enough or fast enough, but I'll tell you what, it's an example of how government can make a difference in people's lives was flood recovery. And I give her credit for that. I don't think she's as strong on the environment as I am. I don't think she has as good a record on that. I don't think she has as good of a record on economic issues as I do. But I respect her on the name identification. Let's just talk about that.
Sure.
Just for a second. If we were to go back 2 years ago, Congressman Braley had raised over $5 million and was facing five little-known Republicans. Well, who won that race? It was one of the little-known Republicans, State Senator Joni Ernst. So just like she made the move from the State Senate to the U.S. Senate, just like Tom Vilsack made the move from State Senate to Governor, I think I can make the move from State Senate to U.S. Senate. I think voters are looking for new leaders.
Now, Judge has the support of the National Democratic Party leaders. Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee has endorsed her. You've got support of the local, the state leadership. What's that split say to you?
Well, I have been endorsed by 93 current or former legislators with whom I served. And I think what's important about that is they know I can do the job. And remember, this isn't a debating society. It's not a marketing gimmick. It's not a lifetime achievement award or a popularity contest. This is a job application. I'm running to do the job of being Iowa's next United States Senator. And I have done the job well in the Iowa legislature. Not perfect, right? I'm not perfect, but I've done a good job. And I think the support of those state legislative colleagues is really important because they know I can do the job in the United States Senate for Iowa.
Okay, relatively quickly, yes. And I know this is a difficult question. We'll talk a little bit about your potential opponent, Charles Grassley, in depth later. But how does a little-known state senator beat a Charles Grassley?
Look, he's a living legend. He has been in Washington, D.C. since I was 7. He was first elected in 1974. And he's been in elected office in Iowa since 9 years before I was born, since 1958. And I respect him. I think he has done some things very well. I like the fact that he casts his votes. I have heard from people they think he does a good job with constituent service. Well, those are things I aspire to do and I believe have done. Not perfect, but I think I've done those well as a state senator. And so I think it comes down to this question, Steve. Who's going to do the best job for our state, our country, and our future over the next 6 years? I have a really positive vision of building a safe, healthy, prosperous, sustainable future. And we need Congress to work to do that. And I think I'm the best person to do that and move our state and our country forward.
Okay. Thank you very much. We appreciate it. Well, up next, we talk about the environment. It's one of Senator Hoag's big priorities, from climate change to water quality. Hear why State Senator Rob Hoag is so passionate about this issue.
And welcome back to KCCI 8 News Close Up. Our guest this morning is U.S. Senate candidate, Democrat Rob Hoag.
That's right. He's a state senator. And, Senator, back in 2010, you helped form the Cedar Rapids Watershed Coalition following the record flooding across the state in 2008 that many of us will never forget. You now serve as co-chair of that group. What does that group do?
Well, this was a citizen-led initiative that came out of the flood of 2008. And we said if citizens didn't lead the effort, we would be right back in the same problems that we'd had before, not only with flooding, but also with water quality. So we're working with a cooperative effort throughout the Cedar River water basin upriver from Cedar Rapids. It's 3.5 million acres. And we get together periodically and highlight successes that farmers are having or cities are having and educating the public about how these things work. And we advocate for more action. I like to say we need to have the same spirit of the sandbag before the next flood that we had during the last flood, because volunteers loved helping out during the flood, and what we need to do is sustain that effort so we can prevent future flood damage and clean up our water.
Well, talk about maintaining quality drinking water. What needs to happen here statewide?
Oh, look, there are so many things that need to be happen. First of all, it's going to require more resources. We need to have more public money into it. We need more private money into it. We need cooperative watershed structures. One of the little-known pieces of legislation that I passed established watershed management authorities so that people could come together across jurisdictional lines to work together on watersheds. So we need that cooperative watershed effort. We need monitoring. We have to know what the quality of the water is. And we need a deadline and a plan and a time frame for action. And I think if we do those things together as Iowans, we can tackle our problems. But don't kid yourself. We have big water quality problems in Iowa. Impaired waterways over 700. We're the second leading contributor to the dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico. And like the Des Moines Water Works, there are a lot of communities that struggle to provide compliant drinking water. So we need to tackle this problem.
Okay, where do you stand on the plans that are out there right now? Some one initiated by the governor, and then there are others on how to pay for cleaning up that agricultural pollution.
Yeah, here's the deal on that, Steve. None of us have really paid this price before. It's a new cost, mm-hmm. and that's why I believe it requires new revenue, and it's why I favor the Natural Resources Outdoor Recreation Trust Fund, which is the 3/8 cent on the sales tax that voters approved in 2010. But the legislature needs to pass, and that would get us additional resources. Then beyond that, if you combine that with, here's the watershed structure for managing the problem, here's the measuring system, and we've got to ask everybody to contribute. This is not just a farm problem. This is an urban problem, it's a stormwater problem, it's a wastewater problem, it's a septic problem. We need to all come together and work on that together. We should not take money from our schools to fund water quality, because we're already short funding our schools.
Well, what do you think about the Des Moines Water Works lawsuit against the three northern Iowa counties?
Look, they have the Des Moines Water Works has a right to bring that lawsuit. I support the Clean Water Act, and I support the right to sue under the Clean Water Act. It is not my preferred solution. I would like to see us come together with a plan and get bipartisan agreement to actually address the problem. I'm not looking very optimistic right now, but you never know. We might be able to change things.
You're shifting gears a bit to climate change,
yes.
Which is a very important issue to you. In fact, you wrote a book about it. When did you become so interested in climate change?
As a sophomore at the University of Iowa in 1986, I had a great class, introduced me to the subject, and then I've just gotten more involved over the years. I got a master's degree in energy policy at the University of Minnesota in 1991, and I've been an advocate for action to address climate change. Here's what people need to know on that, Steve, is none of us ask for the problem of climate change, just like prior generations of Americans didn't ask for the problems they had to deal with. But it's real, it's serious, it's urgent, we need to act on it. And we have the capacity as Americans to unite to deal with this issue. Last week at the legislature, religious leaders from different religious backgrounds, Catholic, evangelical, Jewish, Buddhist, came together to release a joint religious statement on climate change. This is an issue that unites us, and we need to act on this issue.
But so many people believe it doesn't exist and that it's not man-made.
Well, I actually will tell you, Stacey, why I think that is.
Okay.
Because they think the solutions are so hard. And if the solutions sound hard, sometimes you don't want to believe in the problem. And I have really emphasized, we have solutions that work on this. Solar power, one of Iowa's fastest growing industries. Wind power, obviously, great success here. Green buildings. Last week at the Capitol, we had a Chevy Volt up at the Capitol. Transportation solutions. I have a constituent who drove 1,600 miles with a Chevy Volt and only used 2.4 gallons of gasoline. And he also used renewable energy for his electricity. This stuff works. We have solutions that work. That's what people need to know. And when you understand we have solutions that work, then we can say, hey, let's tackle this problem.
Now, you want to go to Washington, but isn't this whole issue of climate change pretty much a non-starter because a recent survey shows that 72% of Republican U.S. senators, the body you hope to join, do not believe in climate change. How can you have an impact there?
Steve, that's one of the reasons I want to go to Washington, is because in order for us to take the action we need on climate change, we need Congress to join the fight against climate change. And look, I understand this wasn't an issue people had to deal with 30 years ago or 40 years ago, right? This is a new issue, but we've got to act on it. And there's so many solutions that work. I really do believe we're very close to uniting this country behind climate action. Not only the action we need to take in this country, but to lead the world to deal with the problem. It is a very urgent problem. I mean, we've just finished the warmest year on record. And the science is clear this is going to get worse. Terrible flooding last week in Houston. that killed 7 people. We need to act on the climate issue.
But there's a lot of big money against it. Mm-hmm. A big money against it.
You know, there are entrenched fossil fuel interests that oppose climate action. But you know what? At the end of the day, we're all human. Nobody is so rich they can avoid the consequences of climate change. And I really do believe in the capacity of people to change and embrace new issues. In my book, I use the line, a doubting Thomas today can be a leader for climate action tomorrow. President Reagan, his original response to stratospheric ozone depletion in the 80s, the ozone hole, was to dismiss it. Well, in 1987, he signed the Montreal Protocol on ozone depleting gases that has helped our country and our world deal with that problem. So we have the capacity to act on these issues, and I think Americans are very close to taking the action we need.
All right, Senator Hoeg. Well, up next, what's going on at the Iowa State House? We'll talk to Senator Hoeg about his work at the state capitol.
Welcome back to Close Up. Our guest this morning, U.S. Senate candidate and state senator Rob Hoeg.
Well, the Republican-controlled Iowa House passed a Health and Human Services bill for the next budget that would remove state funding for Planned Parenthood. Where does this bill stand in the Democrat-majority Senate?
Well, we have just taken that up. Okay. at the end of the week, and we do not support defunding Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood provides, first of all, no money, state money goes to abortions at Planned Parenthood. That just doesn't happen. And Planned Parenthood is one of the key providers for preventative services and other exams. So we're not in favor of that. I think we'll be able to prevail on that, or else we're in for a very long legislative session.
Well, Democrats have not been very happy about the move to privatize the Medicaid program in the state. Your thoughts on how it's going so far and how maybe this process can be improved?
I think the whole concept was flawed in the first place, because what it does is it shifts money from Iowa providers and Iowa patients to out-of-state for-profit companies. And so you've got money leaving the state. We had a well-run public Medicaid system in the country, recognized as a well-run system. But beyond the sort of ideological, whether it was the right thing to do, it's really been botched badly because people have lost their relationships with case managers and providers. Just today, I got an email from a woman who was not able to buy prescriptions for her daughter, earlier this morning, I got that email. And it's really bad because it's taking away people's ability to have those relationships with their doctors. And I'm very concerned about it. We need a good oversight provision at this point so that Iowans know that providers and patients in Iowa will be treated fairly.
Now, what about the medical cannabis bill at the State House? Where does that stand?
Well, nothing's over until it's over. I don't think there's much chance that's going to pop out of the House. We passed it out of the Senate last year in 2015. I am not interested in recreational use of marijuana at all. But when you have patients and parents and doctors talking to you about the suffering of people, I think give them the chance. If they think it will work, they ought to have the chance at it. That's actually something that we can fix at the national level, too. We need to fix it at the national level. So I'm supportive of that. I do not believe in recreational use of marijuana, though, because I think marijuana use for recreationally is a public health problem.
Okay, and you're currently serving in your third term in the state Senate, and is there a piece of legislation this session that you're particularly proud of that you've been a part of?
Well, we have worked really hard on legislation to provide Iowans with a statutory right of assistance to call law enforcement officials without facing reprisals by landlords. That legislation has not been concluded yet, but I think we've got an agreement. I think we're going to be able to get that done. And that's important for victims of domestic abuse and other crimes, so they feel free to call the police without facing reprisals.
Okay. Well, our conversation with Senator Hogue continues up next here on Close Up. His final thoughts on the race, including the hot topic in Washington, the next U.S. Supreme Court judge.
And welcome back to KCCI 8 News Close Up. Our guest is U.S. Senate candidate and state senator Rob Hogue. Now, you've said you are an experienced legislator who can make a dysfunctional and unpopular Congress work again. How do you do that?
Well, I think a couple of things. First of all, you need to elect people who are dedicated to making Congress work. Remember, just 3 years ago, less than 3 years ago, Congress actually shut down the government. And I consider that one of the most unpatriotic things elected officials could do. I was there in 2011. We went to June 30th in the legislative session to the brink of a shutdown. And I cast really tough votes for things I didn't really believe in, because it was part of a deal to keep the government functioning. And so I've been there, I've done it, and I think we need that attitude in Washington, D.C. and Congress. I want to add to it, we also need to change the way we do campaigns. Because right now there's so much money and it's so much negativity, it makes it hard for Congress to function. So I'm focused on meeting people, I'm raising as much money as I can, but I'm focused on meeting Iowans, and I'm going to try my best. I won't do a perfect job of it, but we've got to change this tit-for-tat world we live in, all this negative garbage. We've got to uplift our democracy, and I think that's how you make Congress work again.
Okay, now we have to talk about Senator Grassley's refusal to grant Senate hearings and a vote on President Obama's Supreme Court nominee Merrick Garland. Your take on this?
Well, look, it's a bunch of thoughts on it, but we really need a ninth Supreme Court justice. It's what the law requires. There's plenty of time. If you go back through the history of Supreme Court appointments, number one, everybody who's been nominated has gotten a hearing unless he or she was voluntarily withdrawn. And second, if you look at justices who have died since 1910, every one of those vacancies has been filled within 6 months and 13 days. Well, at that rate, we'd have this vacancy filled by the end of August, just in time for the 2016-17 term of the Supreme Court. We've got to have a hearing. We need an up or down vote. That's the way the process works. And try to fill this vacancy on the Supreme Court.
Does that show you that maybe Senator Grassley is no longer his own man, that maybe somebody else is calling the shots?
Well, here's my concern about it. The Senator Grassley that most Iowans know from the 80s and 90s and earlier in his career, he voted for Supreme Court nominees of presidents of both parties. President Clinton's nominees, Stephen Breyer and Ruth Bader Ginsburg, he voted for. Well, now he's changed. He votes no to President Obama's nominees, Sonia Sotomayor and Elena Kagan. He votes no on Loretta Lynch for Attorney General. And now he's not even giving the president the opportunity to fill the vacancy. President Obama is president till next January. He has the constitutional duty to nominate someone. The Senate has a constitutional duty that Senator Grassley has recognized time and time again to have a hearing and provide an up or down vote. And that's the way this process is supposed to work.
Senate Republicans say they're abiding by the Biden rule.
Yeah, well, that Biden rule is a lot of puffery on their part. Then Senator Biden said things hypothetically that maybe we shouldn't have hearings in July and August when there's an election and wait to have the hearings till in November after the election. Well, that's totally different. They're saying the next president should get to make the selection. And that's really putting, Senator Grassley's really putting his party ahead of the good of our country and now ahead of our Constitution. And that's not the way the system's supposed to work. We need people to work together. He should have, in my opinion, he should have said to the president, here's a list of names of people who I think would be acceptable, and the president should have been able to review those names, and they should have been able to find somebody mutually agreeable. I think Judge Garland's an American hero. He led the investigation and the prosecution, and he deserves a hearing.
All right. Thank you very much, Senator Ho. We will see you next Sunday on Close Up. Thank you very much for joining us today.